Today we're going to talk about Medical School Histology Basics, Introduction to Microscopy. We want to learn a little bit about differences in magnification and resolution, a little bit about how to calculate resolution, a little difference in staining of the different types of staining to observe different tissues at the light microscopic level, look at different organelles at the electron microscopic level, see what happens for different magnifications at the electron microscopic level, and different types of electron microscope images. That would be like the regular transmission, the scanning EM, or the carbon replica transmission electron microscopy. Thank you. Medical School Histology Basics, Introduction to Microscopy. Hi, I'm Larry Johnson. I'm a professor at Texas A&M University. Today we're going to talk a little bit about microscopy. We want to look at differences in magnification and resolution, to learn a little bit about different types of staining at light microscopic level, and some things about details that we see at the electron microscopic level, learn how cell and organelles look different at different magnifications at the electron microscopic level, and to learn about differences in different types of electron microscopic images. These are the four basic specimens that we'll be looking at today as we talk about microscopy. One is the pancreas, and we can see pancreatic astrocytes cells that produce pancreatic enzymes. And in here, the lighter staining are the islet Langerhans that produces insulin. Here we see blood cells of different type. There's eosinophil, neutrophil, red blood cells, different blood cells that we'll see. And here is the mucosa of the stomach. And here we see the parietal cells, and there's some chief cells in there as well. And then we'll end up with the testis, showing you the tubes, the cells in the tubes, and then the interstitial cells between the Leydig cells in between. Just wanted to say that these are atlas views, and it'd be very handy if you would use your atlas to be able to observe these structures, because indeed the structures themselves are labeled so you can identify the various components that you're looking for. Now, what's the difference in magnification and resolution? Now, magnification is simply the increase in the image size. Just keep increasing in size. But if you do that, you will go into empty magnification, namely that you will not gain anything by increasing the image size. Resolution is the important part about microscopy. It's the smallest distance that can be seen between two points. If you ever look down a straight railroad track and you note that as you look, the distance look like the two rails become together and then they come one. You know they don't come together. What you're doing is you're losing resolution with distance, so you can't distinguish between the two rails anymore. That's resolution. And resolution can be calculated by formula: constant 0.61 times the wavelength divided by the numerical aperture, or the light gathering capacity of whatever microscope you have. For your naked eye, you usually see things in millimeters, but for a light microscope, it's micrometers that we see. 0.25 micrometers is your resolution. The resolution for electron microscope is nanometers. So we go from millimeters, micrometers, and nanometers in terms of much finer detail can be seen with the electron microscope. And the reason the resolution is so much smaller with electron microscope is because of wavelength of light. In the electron microscope, we use electrons. Electron is much smaller than white light. As a consequence, you have a smaller number at the very top. And so the resolution is better at the electron microscopic level. Now, as we look at different components of microscopy, we can see one thing that we want to see is the blood cells. This is individual cell, another individual cell. And by looking at blood cells, you can see individual ones, and don't be confused with the cells in the tissue. This is a eosinophil, monocyte, basophil. Here we see eosinophil, neutrophils. As we see, these are all from the atlas and identified for you. Now, the point of this lab is not to identify white blood cells yet. We will have a whole lab on blood. But the point here is just to look for different colors and the staining characteristics that facilitates those differences in colors. And basically, the neutrophil, eosinophil, and basophil all have the lobulated nucleuses, lobes. You can see different lobes. And then the granules are small in a neutrophil, but eosinophil are bigger red granules. And then the basophil has big granules too, but they're blue. And then the lymphocyte is the smallest one, and the horseshoe-shaped one is the monocyte that we can see. Basically, that's it. At electron microscopic level, you can see there are some granules, but they're smaller in the neutrophil than they are in the eosinophil and the basophil. So these two have larger granules. This is eosinophil. It has a crystalline core in this granule that you don't see in the basophil. And then we don't see any granules. We just see mitochondria. And then here is a monocyte. So if we look at one of our blood samples, we see many of these cells are red blood cells, and the little dots in there are the platelets. So here we see a monocyte. There's a lymphocyte here and here, but that's a neutrophil that we see. We look at this one at 110, we can see a neutrophil, which you can hardly see the granules, and then you can see the eosinophil with the big red granules. Both of these are a lobulated nucleus, and both of them about 12 to 15 micrometers in size. So here we see more neutrophils, and here's a basophil, where the lobulated nucleus and blue granule. More neutrophils, red blood cells, as we can see. Here we see the platelets, nicely staining platelets, and the red blood cells are stacked up and through there, and the neutrophils. In a neutrophil, you don't see the granules, you just see a granularity of it because the granules are not that large. And in fact, if you look at a neutrophil electron microscopic level, you can see the different lobes of the nucleus. So this is the nucleus, and then these are the granules. Granules that you can see in these neutrophils that we see through here. And so these are different ones, are neutrophils. See, this monocyte doesn't have the granules that you see in the neutrophil. So if we leave blood and go to the pancreas, you see the pancreatic acinar cells that produce pancreatic juices are located in through here, and you see the kind of blue at the bottom and then kind of red in the middle. We'll talk about that later. And then the clear cells in the center are the cells from the islets of Langerhans, beta cells, alpha cells, beta cells that produce insulin. So if we take a look at that, we can see the lighter staining is the endocrine part, and the acinar cells is the exocrine part, namely these secretions go in a duct, and these do not. If you look at hematoxylin and eosin are the two stains that we use in combination, and the acid dye is eosin. So the acid dye, eosin, it stains proteins red. So what we see here in the lumen in through there are proteins that are produced. They're the enzymes. And the basic dye is from hematoxylin, and it stains ribosomes and nucleic acid nucleus blue. So here you see the blue, the nucleus here, and the bluish tint to the cytoplasm is due to the high density of ribosomes in the rough and the plasma reticulum. So therefore, the staining characteristics tell you about what's inside the cell. Is it more acid, which would be in the ribosome in the nucleus? Then it would be blue. If it's more proteinaceous, it would be red, like these granules. And we can see it very nicely here. Secretory granules are red as they are protein-rich in enzymes. That's what we see in here. So it's stained with the eosin. In contrast, the basal portion of the cell is blue. You can see blue here because it has a high density of ribosomes. So that's with H&E. But if you look when it was turned in blue, everything's blue. And you have to look at the cells at varying intensities. The intensity tells you about it. You can see the dark granules in through there that we saw in the previous one. The granules are located in the lumen, clear cytoplasm in through there. You go by the shape, size, and the darkness indicate the density of the tissue. So everything's blue here, as opposed to hematoxin is, you look at tinctorial or color characteristics to tell you what's there. But here you have to look at shape, size, and darkness. So if we look at hematoxin and eosin stain versus diluted in blue versus electron micrograph, we can see these granules are indeed these dark granules that you see. Here's a lumen in through there, so the cells are getting nutrients in the bloodstream down below, and cells are processing things and emptying them into this lumen, and that's part of the exocrine component of the pancreas. So these are secretory granules that you see there. You can also see them in the diluted in blue. So you can see the granules are located right in through here, right where they are here in the hematoxylin and the eosin. And you see, so those are protonation, protein, eosin staining in the case of H&E. Also down in here, you see rich swirls of things. This is a rough in the plasma reticulum. So it's the ribosomes on them that gives a blue tint to it. So blue tint, like the nucleus, is blue because of the nucleic acids that are in the ribosomes or in the nucleus. So what we see there with the diluted in blue, all we see is kind of smooth cytoplasm, and that is the rough in the plasma reticulum with the ribosomes. Another tissue we want to look at is the mucosa of the stomach. So the mucosa is the epithelium, lining the stomach. It is the lamina propria and the muscularis mucosa. So those three things make a mucosa. And we'll look at the mucosa. Here's the mucosa. This is a submucosa, connective tissue of the submucosa. So if we look at the mucosa, we can see a couple of types of cells. Chief cells produce pepsinogen and parietal cells that produce hydrochloric acid. So you can see the big cells here are the parietal cells in bluish tint with these vesicles in through here are the chief cells. And so they produce two different things. And here we can see them again. These are chief cells and the parietal cells. Now, if we look at those same cells with telutin in blue, we can see the secretions of the chief cells. But also on the parietal cells, we can see there's granularity in there. This granularity is the mitochondria. So you can see mitochondria in there. Here you can see the chief cells, the secretions in both of these. And then in the parietal cell, we can see these dots in here. See these little dots around here? All these are mitochondria. Mitochondria is important in transport hydrochloric acid outside the cell. Chloride is one way, and hydrogen is also being pumped out. Here we see some nuclei. This is the nucleus of a chief cell, nucleus of the parietal cell, and a nucleus of a fibroblast that surrounds there. The telutin in blue will let you see some cytoplasmic detail. In this case, we can see the mitochondria that we cannot see with H&E. The other tissue is the testis. And here we see the capsule, we see the seminiferous tubules, and in between there are Leydig cells that produce testosterone. And here we see the Leydig cells in through there. We see some nice fibroblasts in through here. We can see a lymphatic endothelial cells. This is probably an arteriole, a little arteriole, maybe a bigger one. And then a host of germ cells. Some are round and some look like bullets. Just to illustrate the fact that tissue is transparent and you have to stain it. The reason you stain it is to stain it differently. So you can see some different components in there. But as a rule, tissue, if it's not stained, is transparent. For example, we're looking through the cornea of our eye, and if it wasn't transparent, we wouldn't be able to see through it. But mostly tissue, unless it's specifically pigmented, is transparent, and you have to stain it to be able to see it. Also, this staining facilitates you to observe cells, but these cells are all dead. And we're using bright field microscopy to observe stained cells. If you want to look at live cells, you need to use phase contrast microscopy or differential interference contrast microscopy, a different type that we're not using. So here you see an H&E of the testis. You can see the bullets of the more mature spermatids. You see these primary spermatocytes. But take a look at these Leydig cells in through there. There's a nucleus of one, a nucleus of one we see with telutin in blue. And you can see lipid details. There's lipid inside here, which you can see little white spots here, but you can't see the cytoplasmic detail with H&E that you can with telutin in blue. Telutin blue is what people use before they locate what tissue they're looking at with electron microscope. And electron microscope has different images that you can see. And what you want to be is a little bit mindful of magnification that you have there. When you think about magnification of a light microscopic level, think about a red blood cell. You can always see a red blood cell in a tissue somewhere, and it should be about 7 micrometers. Use that as a gauge to determine relative magnification. In the case of electron microscopy, a good thing to use is a ribosome. Ribosome is a good thing to indicate that you can use mitochondria as well. So what we have here is a lowest magnification going to the highest magnification. Here we can see the lipid bilayer in the membrane. We cannot see it over here. So if we start with a 90,000 magnification, we can see these neutrophilic granules that we talked about before, the monocyte. We can see mitochondria that are in. We can see some granularity in these lymphocytes, but you can see mitochondria for sure. If you look at these cells, these polychromatic normal blasts, these are precursor to red blood cells. You can see the nucleus there, and you can see ribosomes in through there. We see mitochondria a little larger at 13,000. We go to 60,000. We can see mitochondria quite a bit larger, and you can see ribosomes very distinctly here. This is in the rough and the plasma reticulum. There's a Golgi up there, but the mitochondria's got is more defined. Same magnification, we can see microtubules, microfilaments, but we can see the mitochondria, and here's the ribosomes of the polyribosomes in through there. If you jump to 80,000, ribosomes are quite bigger, and so the mitochondria are larger as well. And finally, if we jump to 200,000, you can see the lipid bilayer. You can see the two layers, two dark and one light. right in the very center, you can see microtubules. This is a centriole with the microtubules. So if you just look at mitochondria, you can see they increase with magnification. That's a different view, different details. And then if you look at ribosomes, you see their increases of ribosomes here much bigger than those and those based on the magnification. Also, there are different types of microscopy. Usually you talk about transmission electron microscopy, you're talking about conventional transmission electron microscopy that we've seen so far. This is not. This is carbon replica electron microscopy. It's good for surface detail. And here we see the zonal occlutants where two cells are attached together. This is another carbon replica, and this is a lymphocyte. You can see the nucleus. You can see nuclear pores. You can see the mature face of the plasma membrane. This is a different type too. This is scanning electron microscopy, good for surface detail, as you can see. This is scanning EM of a kidney. This is a nephron, a glomerulus that we see. And so in terms of conventional transmission electron microscopy, this one and that one that we saw earlier is conventional. These two are scanning electron microscopy, and these two are carbon replica. And so in summary, remember, use your atlas to be able to identify the different structures that we see because they're labeled already there for you. Use your atlas is very important. One question that we want to ask, which type of microscopy or staining is better for observing cellular detail? Light microscopy with telutin blue with H&E, or transmission electron microscopy, typical EM staining? And the answer is telutin blue can see more detail, more detail in cytoplasm than you can H&E, but transmission is by far the more, has a higher resolution to be able to see more detail. So here is the Santa Ana Canyon in Big Bend, Texas National Park in Texas. Over here is Mexico, and over here is the United States. So this is the end of Medical School Histology Basic, Introduction to Microscopy. Hope you'll be able to identify some of these structures and be able to use this information. If so, please consider subscribing to VIBS Histology. Thank you.